Halter, the guru of data and statistics for the Rails system. And I have admired all of his work that he's produced for them and would love to clone him and have someone like him working for us down here. And I reached out to him and asked him to do this presentation today, and he graciously agreed. So I appreciate it. And I'm going to turn it over to him now. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Anna. I can tell you, I've gotten so many data nicknames, data magician and all kinds of things in there. They're all lovely. But the hope today is that we demystify data and data analysis and all those things. So hopefully everyone can be a little more comfortable with all the data things. So a little bit about me before I get into the presentation is I'm the data analysis manager at Rails. I'll go ahead and share my screen real quick. So I'm the data analysis manager at Rails. I've been here for 4 years now doing all kinds of data things, writing surveys, analyzing data, gathering data, presenting data, strategic planning, project planning, all that kind of fun stuff. Anything that involves data, really, I want to be involved in. So before this, I did many of the same things, but at Oak Park Public Library, which is a larger suburban public library in outside of Chicago. I was there for 2.5 years doing the same stuff, surveys, working with the librarians, strategic planning, all kinds of data stuff. And that's my background, is using math, but in practical real life situations, not the scary theoretical stuff that breaks my brain all the time. So I'm here to talk about data, gathering data a little bit, but mostly diving into the stats and especially IPLR stats right now as the examples. And talk about how we can move away from the core stats of visits, CERCs, program attendance as kind of the default performance metrics for our libraries, and how we can manipulate those and go a little deeper to get more useful insights to help kind of build the context around your library and help advocate for your services. So let's just dive right into it. So the importance of gathering good data. Well, first of all, what does good data mean? Well, I count that as data that is thoughtfully collected from a known and trusted source. So you have to start asking yourself questions about how is the data compiled? Were there any filters? What are the conditions with all of that? When you're pulling that data, how are you exporting it? Are there hidden filters? There aren't any surprises when you're going to analyze that data in the future. So for IPLR, as an example, that's an intentional data collection, but it's done by humans. So there's plenty of error and just kind of misleading numbers at times, depending on how you look at it. So before you start using the data, you always want to ask yourself a few questions. Just quick overview of what's the largest number, what's the smallest number, like what are those outliers? Because outliers can be concerning, misleading, they can skew the results, but knowing that can also be useful in certain ways, and we'll dive into that a little bit later. But also, are there missing data? Are there blank cells in the spreadsheet? What does that mean, and how does that impact kind of any work or any analysis you do with that in the future? But in general, good data in equals good data out. And that good data out might not always be what you want it to be if your numbers are lower or the trend is going in a different way than you expect, but you can trust it at the very least. So it's really important to do those same kind of double checks on the front end when you're gathering the data or inputting the data so that you know you can trust it on the other end. And building those data literacy skills are critically important for libraries. For IPLR at Oak Park, we had a bunch of spreadsheets just tracking the numbers on a monthly basis. So it wasn't all a big mad rush at the end of the fiscal year to gather the numbers. And that's really, really important, is have some of the basic spreadsheet skills and comfortability with those, of organizing columns and rows and using tables to be able to sort and filter. so that you can organize that data and it doesn't get messed up or missing or anything like that. But also you want, as you have that data, you want to be able to analyze it appropriately. So how comfortable are you interpreting graphs and dashboards and navigating those things? What's the scale of the data? But also remembering that this graph or this metric is just one piece of the larger puzzle in the library world. If you go to your board and say, hey, look at this stat, this means we should get more money, they're probably going to laugh at you because that's just one small piece. And we all know there's a lot more going on in the library. So data can be scary and intimidating sometimes, but it's all about how you package it. If you find the right piece, then you just kind of build that into your narrative as a supporting piece, because as long as the data is good, then it's hard to argue against if you've prepared it the right way. So hopefully the statistics we go through and all the data isn't intimidating, that it's here to help inform your decision making. And I know slogging through large data sets of raw numbers really melt people's brains a lot of times, but they can be really useful in being effective and efficient when assessing your library's performance, and they can be impactful tools for advocating for your library, whether it's showing, hey, we're doing great compared to everyone else, or hey, we're lagging behind and here's what we need to do a little better. So we're going to wander through a few examples, live examples, bear with me, a live demo of IPLAR dashboard, fun things today. This is all the lecturing I hope to do today. Please ask any questions. That's part of the fun of data analysis, is exploring all the different numbers and what looks weird. I have a set example to go through, but if any of you are curious about your own numbers and want to be the guinea pig today, I'm happy to highlight your library and we'll do the analysis on the spot. All righty, so we're going to jump into this first table. Hopefully it looks familiar. This is all IPLAR data, and I have it filtered just for Heartland libraries at the moment. Visits, total CERCs, and total program attendance. This is usually the default stats numbers that people use and the board asks for and you send to show progress, and they're good. And they certainly help provide context for where the library is. Especially if you have multiple years, you can go back and say, how have we been doing for the last 5 years, up and down, or flat. That can be useful, but looking at only these numbers in this way only gets you so far. I'll start by, I've been using St. Clair County because they have a healthy number of libraries in there and a decent dispersion of the numbers. So I'm going to start by sorting by visits. And right off the bat, you can see there's a high library, there's some in the middle, there's some lower, there's missing data, IPLAR things happen. Maybe that's my error, maybe I missed that data set. And sorting high to low just helps you more quickly see, okay, relative to visits, how are the CERCs, how are the program attendance, who's high, who's low. Again, you can only get so far looking at these raw numbers because even my brain starts to fog over at one point, but you can see, are there outliers, who's similar to me, and just opens the door to say, hey, to ask, what are they doing differently? How can we do better? Things like that. So I want to take your attention to these bolded numbers at the bottom. And excuse the ground total, I can't actually change that label, unfortunately, in this software. But this set is the median of the numbers of the data set. So 15,000 is the middle number of the data set. I know a lot of people say average. When they want the average, what I think they actually mean is medians. You want the number that's closest to the middle. So this number is how many, it shows that there are an equal number of libraries above and below that number. And if you place that, that's exactly what Lebanon is right now. And that's an important number because if you use average, then you're going to get a skewed number, either higher or lower than the actual middle based on how skewed those numbers, what the outliers look like. For visits, it's not that different, so it's not as useful, but for material CERCs, you can see the average is 13,900, but the median is 13,900, and that fits. If we sort this, you say, okay, about 13,000 is that 7th out of 14 library, but the average is 38,000. So if you were to go and say, oh, yeah, the half of the libraries are around 38,000, that wouldn't be as useful, because you can see, because O'Fallon and Belleville skew those CERC numbers so much higher, that 38,000 would be the third highest number in this list. And it wouldn't account for all these other libraries that are actually more similar to that middle number, that 13,900. So always beware of that. I know average is like by far the star of the show in a lot of stats things, but think about median. That function exists in Excel, and it's easy to calculate as long as you have each of the numbers to review. And that's a big thing that I always try to highlight in these stats presentations is median. I love median. It's great. But also average can be useful because it shows you how skewed the numbers are if those outliers are as big as they are. So then we're going to go a little deeper next with the CERCS total materials and program attendance. My hair is a little wonky today. And go into looking into some ratios. And I'm sure you all have done this stuff before, but we're just going to dive into it real quick. And so the first ratio I have is CERCS per visit. Some of you may have done this before. I don't see it too often in board reports or anything, but I think it can be a useful number in certain contexts. Again, it's not ever going to be the end-all be-all number that says, ha, give us more money because we have high CERCS per visit, but it's always part of the discussion, part of the narrative that you're trying to play. So let's go up here again and sort by St. Clair, get our 14 libraries back. And I kept the raw numbers just for reference. And if I sort by CERCS per visit, you see a different picture. I'm not gonna try to pronounce that, but this top library is 5.9. That looks like a good number. How do we know? Because the median and the average are around 1.3 for this county. So whatever they're doing, whether they're counting right or wrong, or their numbers are legit, maybe that's a library to go ask, hey, how are you getting such great CERC numbers for average sized service area? You get a lot of CERC. What's going on there? That's pretty cool. You can see the others, see the average, see the lower. Who knows where the numbers came from, but there's all kinds of factors, different borrowing policies, different setups, different open hours. A lot of variables impact these kind of numbers, but this gives you a guide that is quicker and easier to see than trying to gauge, okay, 5,431,000 versus 1,700, 5,600, how do those numbers compare? I can't do that mental math in my brain. But with this ratio, you just do it quick and you can see how it compares all those libraries regardless of volume. You see O'Fallon is large and they have one of the higher CERCs per visits, but not the highest. So there's just different variables going on. So then I'll jump to average program attendance. We'll sort that again. See right off the bat, that looks like an outlier. I don't know if it's right or wrong because I don't know the details of that library. It makes me think back to, was it 2018 when the solar eclipse came through and all of our library stats, the visit counter, the CERC counter for that day were all kinds of skewed. So it wasn't wrong, but it wasn't as useful that day. It wasn't as useful when we're looking at the annual assessment. But you can see there's a lot of variation. Programs are very library specific, as everybody knows. You might have more or less, and you might have more small programs or a few big programs. And that's all important context to take when you're looking at kind of these peer libraries and trying to learn what others are doing. You'll also notice that I used average program attendance instead of my favorite median program attendance. And that's because we only had the totals here, just dividing that attendance number by the number of programs. If I wanted median program attendance, I would need the program attendance for each individual program lined up, sorted, and finding that middle spot, which is harder to do for peer libraries, but you could certainly do that for your own library, just looking at a list of your program attendance. environmentals and looking how that's trended over the years could be useful, certainly. This is a great example, again, of median program attendance is median average program attendance. That might be a skewed. I don't know about that, actually. But you can see 18.5, 51.2 just shows that there's some libraries skewing the number higher. So median's better when you have that outlier. And then next, I'm going to move on to the fun things that I really get digging into at system level is this operating expenditures per capita number. Varies wildly and surprisingly in terms of kind of how the volumes of the libraries work. So let's go ahead and find our favorite. Actually, no, we're going to sort this by all of Heartland first before going to St. Clair. See, there's some libraries up here that have high operating budgets per capita. And just from knowing a few of these, they're in larger cities or towns. They have a mall that many people go to, so they just have different tax revenue going on there. But you see the median is down at 32. So the half of the libraries are above $32 per person and half are below. So that all plays into that calculation. It's not quite skewed because the average is 37, but all useful in context. And when we pull out St. Clair again, we can see, okay, the highest is Smithton. They haven't come up in either of my previous examples, so that's interesting. O'Fallon was kind of the high volume. And you can see there's a decent spread, but their median is still similar to Heartland as a whole. So that's another great way when you're trying to compare resources and different services and programs you offer. Maybe a library just has more money per person, or maybe they have less than you expected because their total operating expenditures might be in the millions and yours is only 500,000, but per capita, you might be on a more level playing field than you might realize just because you have different volumes. You'll see I did a lot of other kind of comparisons with this per capita and per circ, and some of them are more or less useful. Like, I'll jump to program attendance per capita. To be honest, I don't know what this number means. I know some are higher, some are lower. What is 0.05 attendees per service? I mean, I know I can talk through that in a sentence, but I'll admit I don't know the significance of it. So not all stats are useful, but they might be interesting. But we're here to look at the useful ones. So I'll jump back here to circulations per capita. You see, okay, decent spread. O'Fallon's notably higher than the rest, but there's still a good clump in the middle. Median and average are there. But what I notice here is, okay, since this is sorted highest to lowest, how does this compare to our operating expenditures per capita? See, okay, there's some in the 40s, another in the 40, but once you get lower, you tend to trending lower operating budget per capita correlates with circs per capita. So that could be a one piece of the puzzle when you're talking to your board is we want to increase our circ numbers or circ per capita number. We see a correlation that if there's more money, more resource in the library, then you could expect the circs per capita to increase by either buying books or promoting the library differently. A lot of different ways you can use that money. But in general, you see that correlation. But if you don't have that option to advocate for more funds, you could see, okay, Lebanon looks like they're doing pretty well. They're at the average, but they have a lower operating budget per capita, expenditure per capita. Maybe it's worth reaching out to them, seeing what are they doing differently? How are they counting their numbers to build that context to help inform your next decision. What was next? So users per capita, I always like to dig into, and it's slightly useful in the county system, but when you go out to all of Heartland and get all of the libraries, you see 107%, actually that probably shouldn't be percent. No, that should be percent. 107% of the population there are carts for. So that means there's more cards than population. That doesn't mean it's wrong. There are a lot of libraries don't have cards that expire, So that's just part of the context that you have to keep in mind. And it makes this number a little difficult to assess, because these higher numbers in the 70s, maybe they don't have cards that expire, but they just haven't reached that 100% of the service population. So I've heard that users per registered cards per your service area, people like to look at that as a metric of success for libraries. And it can be, but you really have to know those numbers and what's going in to the purge, patron purge processes, who's being taken out, who's being left in, how big is the population, all those kinds of things. So I just wanted to point that one out, because you see the median is 16%, but there's certainly many above, many below. When I was at Oak Park, we had we were above 100% at one point. And then I, as the data person, said, we have to purge all of these users that haven't used the library in 7 years or 5 years. I forget what the actual length was. And it dropped down to 48% or 50%. And on the surface, that didn't look good for the library management. But once we explained the number, it's like, okay, it was a skewed metric. It wasn't useful or a measure of success before, because the data wasn't good data in, so we were getting bad data out. So we had to fix that, so we at least know where our true baseline was to move forward. So that was my little soapbox about users per capita. So that's the basics. I hope I wasn't going too far, too fast. If there are any questions, let me know. Happy to go through anyone's specific library if they're curious, just to dig into it. If one second just for that. If not, I will just dive into the end. And the second part is my favorite part, is scatter plots. This is a published dashboard. I can publish the first one on the web if y'all want to explore that, but have a little diagram in this one on the Rails website that shows how to read a scatter plot, but you don't have to read this now because you get me to review it with you right now. So this is a scatter plot, and we're going to sort to Heartland real quick, only Heartland, of population versus operating expenditures. So how you read this graph is you highlight over a bubble. And you see, okay, Danville population is 33,000, operating expenditure is 1.9 million. And you can see that dot appears because it comes on the x-axis, right about 33, 1.9 on the operating expenditures budget. So you can use this to find other peer libraries or compare how you're doing against the average by where your dot lands. And I know it's not always useful to look at the largest ones. So let's skew to everyone less than, okay, $800,000. You see a lot more dots skewed above this line, below this line. This white line is the average. So only public libraries right smack dab on the middle of operating expenditures per capita. Regardless of their volume, you see there's libraries above and below the line. North, south, east, west of it, effectively, but their average, and they compare with these other lines that are farther left and lower on the line, but they're still on the line. And the distance from this line just equates to the magnitude. I can tell I'm already getting too deep because my brain is fogging over as well. But in general, so East St. Louis is lower on that operating budget per capita spectrum, and Mahomet is a little higher. And I can point out when we saw Roxana was the highest one on Heartland, and they're, even though they're lower on this graph relative to the line, they're the farthest away in this group. So I like using this. I filter this by population, so I can really get a big group of these libraries and look, okay, if I'm Tri-City, who's near me, who's above me, that has the same population but more budget, who's to the right of me that has more population and the same budget, how is that useful? Gotta contact them, see what they're doing differently, but also all just for building that case to advocate for your library. All these little different data points can help build your case as well. And this is just operating budget per capita. I've built a few more for fun. This is total building square footage per population, because I've heard in the rumors of Library Direct world that there's a threshold of two square feet per person, 1 square foot per person, something like that. And that's generally what the average is. So if you're looking at building a new building or think yours is too small, you could find your dot in this graph and say, oh, all our peer libraries that we think are our peers have larger buildings. How could that improve our services if we were on a level playing field with them? Of course, lots of other variables go into that, but this, hopefully this data is available to give people the access to find those answers. Visits per population, we saw that in the table of just the raw numbers, but not everyone's a raw data numbers kind of person like the visual. I'm a visual person. I love all these graphs. So seeing how this spread is, how it accounts, I can filter these things and see that's an interesting spread. What does it mean? There's some outliers here in both directions. There's a lot in the middle. And it's all good. I think that's all. I totally jumped from my notes, but I think I got all of the points I wanted to hit. I guess for peer libraries, I'll mention the core numbers that I look into just for quick and easy peer libraries is what are their visits? What are their circs? What's their geography? Not just how far are they away from me, but is their library in the middle of town? Is it next to the high school? Is it out farther away? How does that impact how people use the library? What's the service population? What's their operating expenditures? And that operating expenditures per capita to all kind of find a ballpark for here's the 10 libraries that are most similar to me. And what are they doing? What are their numbers? How do they differ? And all that fun stuff. I think that's all I had. I'm happy to answer questions or go over other examples. Thanks for your time.
Okay, people can either ask the questions in chat, or you can raise your hand and I can, you can unmute yourself and ask your question. I think it's pretty amazing stuff. I mean, it's like basically you're telling us that anyone can go in and create this data for themselves.
Okay. Yes, absolutely. And I've hopefully done a lot of it to make just a little less burden on you all. Is these tables are on the Rails website. I know we just got the new website, so I'm not exactly sure where that link exists, but I can share it. With everyone, if you're interested.
Yes, somebody wants to know, Carol wants to know if these numbers that are reflected here, are they from COVID times or are they from post-COVID?
So they probably overlap with some COVID times. They're the fiscal 2021 IPLAR numbers. So depending on when your fiscal year is, some might dip into 2020, some are closer to 2021. And this was just one static year. I'm working on building a public dashboard to look at the full last 10 years of IPLAR data that are easy for people to dive into. Haven't gotten into that just yet, but I've certainly gotten plenty of requests to, hey, we want to see the trends of how COVID impacted the libraries. How did the visits go? How did the circs change? I know eCirc skyrocketed and then it's kind of come back a little bit. So so these numbers weren't, I guess, kind of COVID, but they're just one static year. To look through all of it.
We have another question from Michelle. I missed the first few minutes. Where do we find this data?
Yeah, so that is a great question. I know where it was on the old Rails website, and let me just pull up the new Rails website. And see, there's on the Rails website, I don't think it's locked by login or anything. If anything, it'd be your L2 login. At the bottom, there's a data analysis pull. I can do this as a demo. I'll just share my screen real quick. All right, so I am on the new Rails website. If you happen to go to the old Rails website, you get this. And then there's a link up here just to go to the New Rails website. And at the bottom, we have these pulse pages that are kind of like hot topics, current issues. And you click on data analysis, this is everything I've built. So there's all kinds of other stuff, you, of course, focus on Rails in general. But this public IPLR dashboard right here, you just click that, it'll bring you to the scatter plots that I showed, because I haven't published the Heartland one, but I can do that. So that gives you this whole dashboard that you can view and navigate this list of libraries, that there's also a way to export from if you want to play around with those numbers in a spreadsheet yourself. I will post this dashboard that I used probably to this website, because it's, I'll just change the label, because it's not just Heartland, there's Rails libraries in there too, but of course y'all can filter as you go. So I can add that to this list just as another resource.
Do you have anything that shows a comparison, just a kind of a general comparison between IHLS libraries and Rails libraries?
I have done that analysis before. I don't think it's published on the website. Let me look real quick. I did one for the consortia, because we have six consortia in Rails. So we did that. Service area diagrams. I don't think I'm going to be able to come up with it off the top here. I will keep looking as I answer more questions, though.
Okay. Okay, somebody raises the point, I don't mind going to Rails website, but could this be put on the IHLS website? I think we'd have to negotiate that.
Technically, yes, we can add the link. This is all public data, obviously, so you could just FOIA me and get the spreadsheet yourself, but it's easy enough to add a link. We can talk with Heartland staff about how that would look.
Well, I am happy to say that we have many upcoming meetings between Rails staff and IHLS staff, and we're hoping to work more collaboratively in the future. And so who knows? Anything's possible, right?
Yep. I see a hand raised.
Okay. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Grant, this is Cassandra Thompson with IHLS. I had the pleasure of looking at some of your data with the consortial working group. So thank you so much for being here to show everybody this.
Yeah.
My question is just to make sure that we all understand the raw data that is giving us some of these medians. Are there any, like a glossary of how that particular piece is calculated, like what data is being getting input in? Does that make sense? Like from what piece of the IPLR?
Yeah, so I'll go back to, it's a great question. I think I'm choosing the right screen. Okay, so y'all are seeing this dashboard again. So when I share, or when we figure out how to share this dashboard with you all again, you'll see there's all these different tables on the side. And then on the bottom here, I put a quick reference to the IPLR fields in terms of what I call them in this report versus what their title is in the IPLR. And I know that can get a little confusing. And as a data analyst, I hide behind not properly naming things the most efficient way. So if anything's confusing, just let me know. But there's a lot of data in this data set, as you can see. So if there's any requests for other reports or dashboards, I'm happy to make them. It doesn't take that much time to pull stuff together. And I know it's useful for my Rails members too. So it's not just me doing work for Heartland off the side. It's part of the larger Illinois library experience. So happy to build everything, because what's useful to you is probably useful for us as well. So yeah, here's just an example of operating expenditures per CERC. Kind of write that in the those lists. And if any's confusing again, you can just let me know.
Grant, that's wonderful. Thank you so much.
Yeah, of course. And since I'm already sharing, I did find this is an old IPLAR. I don't think it might be 2019 IPLAR, but I did do this comparison of Heartland versus Rails. And this is, there's the median number again. So that's the 50%. And then there's other, the top 10% of libraries in Rails have 43,000 people, top 10% of libraries in Heartland have 15,000. So we were just kind of comparing what the different magnitudes are. And I think we knew we were bigger, but weren't quite sure how much or how close we were in some areas than we realized. I haven't looked at this in several years. So there's my original scatter plots that I've cleaned up, as you can see. And I don't think this one is public, but a lot of it's already existing in the other public dashboards that I've shown. Yeah.
Very interesting. Okay. Are these statistics being imported from Counting Opinions and the dashboard created through Looker Studio? I just want to make sure I understand the process should I want to replicate. Thanks. And Stephen, if you replicate it, let us all know.
Yeah, so I have a fancy admin login to the County Opinion software through the state library. So they give me access to all of the data to build these kinds of things. So yeah, this is all Counting Opinions data. I have access to multiple years, so I can build that stuff out too, and all the IPLAR questions. And some of them are messier in the spreadsheets than others. So these are the easier ones that I can just kind of put together real quick. So Looker Studio is previously known as Google Data Studio. They've rebranded and I don't like it, but this is a Google product. It's Google free, so it's as long as you have an email address, you can use it, but I'm sure they use your data for all kinds of reckless things. But this was how I kind of got myself started in building dashboards. I had all the math and the data background, but this was a free product that I could just upload a data set. Either if you use Google, you can have it in Google Sheets, and it really quickly and simply jumps into this dashboarding software that I also use for, as you see, presentations and internal analysis. And it's just it's an easier, cleaner way than walking people through like an Excel spreadsheet a lot of times, because it's more visually appealing and I can keep it simpler without anyone worrying about breaking the data or deleting stuff. So yeah, I don't know if I'm allowed to recommend it because Rails things, but it's certainly useful. I use Power BI and there's Tableau and other data platforms, but this one's free and it's, I think the barrier to entry is pretty good. And I don't know if you all have access to it, but I did an intro to this tool for the Rails members on our CE continuing education recordings. Mm-hmm. So if anyone's especially interested in that, I can get you secret access and just won't tell anybody. I'm kidding, but I don't think we're trying to hide anything. Carol, I appreciate you acknowledging that you're not a math person, but you still love this. And that's kind of my goal, my tagline, that if you ask anyone I've worked with in the past 8 years in the library world, six years, I forget how long I've worked in libraries, is the data interesting or useful? That's what I always ask myself, because in libraries, there's tons of data looking through the ILS and all that stuff. But it's not always useful. It's not always actionable for your strategic plan or advocating to your board. So I always ask myself that question. But also, yeah, exactly, Carol, that interesting and useful. I find myself falling into rabbit holes real fast. So I try not to waste too much time in that interesting data that actually doesn't apply.
What helps you make that determination when you're looking at data and it's like, well, this is interesting, but this mm-hmm. is really useful? What What helps you decide what's interesting and what's useful?
Yeah, that is part of it, is just experience of knowing how I pointed out that program attendance per capita number. That I think it probably is useful, but just seeing 0.05 of a person like that number just doesn't, I can't comprehend that. So that's kind of your first step, is if you don't know how to use it, if there's no action behind it of, oh, this means this, or this clearly means I need more programs, or I need a different door counter, or whatever that is. That means it might be fun to look through, or you can make a pretty graph with it, but how can you utilize that number for your strategic plan? And when I've done consulting, I've often told people, if you're not sure where to start on what numbers to gather, start at your strategic plan and work backwards. So think, okay, this is our objective. What numbers would we need to say, would we need to show whether we achieve this or not? What numbers do we need to show that we were successful? What could be useful in informing, was this objective completed? What's the trend towards it, up or down, and all that?
Thank you. I've never heard it tied to the strategic plan before. That makes beautiful and perfect sense. So yeah. Thank you for that.
A lot of people try to go the other way around and start with the numbers and build up to a strategic plan. But even I'll admit, I get lost with that sometimes. So start with your plan. You know that in and out, as a director, as your library staff do. So work backwards. Yeah.
Well, Carol said she understands now why the dreaded IPLR is important. I think we all dread, filling out the IPLR, but it is important. And Michelle asks, is this data, is there any kind of data that you have that compares the tax-capped counties to the untax-capped?
I don't come across that too often. Remind me, is tax-capped, is that based on population? Okay. I'm thinking of city. I've been working with city libraries a lot, and at $25,000, they have some kind of.
Yes, there is a level where home rule comes into
home rule,
play
that's
with
right.
with population
so that's
size.
Not and, yeah. So no, I don't have that data, or at least I haven't come across it. If it exists somewhere, it can certainly be applied to, or if someone finds that, you can send it to me and I'll add it to things to make it useful.
Yeah, because I know several of our counties are tax capped, okay, and some are not, but it seems like more and more are becoming so, no one likes to pay taxes, even though they benefit all of us.
So, I mean, that's a great question to ask, though, of you see the data and Michelle, you want to know more, you want to know, okay, how can I better compare? How can I find my peer libraries? And as long as you have that, you can start searching for that tag. I'm sure it's not terribly hard to find how many libraries are tax capped. There's probably some data out there somewhere that we could pull together.
Now, I am assuming that I think I know the state library's website fairly well. I've never seen any of this data, like this kind of data there. Is it not there? And I haven't been overlooking anything is my question.
As far as I know, they haven't posted data like this. I asked them if I had permission to use IPLR data and build these dashboards, and they said, yeah, go ahead. So I think it's just a matter of Rails happens to have a data analyst on staff and other places don't. So we just kind of do with what we have. Yeah, so that's why I'm happy to share it statewide and do this presentation for Ireland, all that fun stuff. Just to more people having more knowledge of data and data literacy helps me, because that just kind of builds the profession slowly but surely.
No, I appreciate that. Are there any more questions? Anyone else have anything? Are you all in stunned silence?
That's fair.
Well, not seeing anyone raise their hand or post anything in chat, I just want to say thank you so very much. This was so useful and so very helpful. And it leaves me with lots of questions and the desire to find out more. So if yeah. that makes sense. So thank you, Grant. I really appreciate it. And we may have you back in future for more of this, because I think this is, as you say, very useful, and it can help move our profession along. You know, if we can prove our case with the data, that helps so much, because we can tell all the wonderful stories about how libraries change lives. And that's part of the equation, and we need those too, but the data is certainly something that supports that. So thank you for the work you do, and thank you for taking the time to share with us today.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for having me.
Okay. And you can join, you can stay with us, or you can leave now. We're going to go into our updates about what's happening here at IHLS. So thanks again, Grant. Okay, Leslie, I see you're there.
I am. Sorry. Good morning, everybody. First is a shout out and a thank you to Grant for joining Members Matter today. We have been talking about what tells the story, right? What tells the story about the needs that you have at your library? What tells the story about the amazing work you're doing at your library? And data is a big part of that. The data visualization piece is a really big part and can tell that story sometimes quicker than words. So thanks again for that. I just have two things that I want to mention from the library system perspective. The ballot is now live for the library system board of directors election. It went live yesterday. It stays open, I believe, through April 15. We have a 15-member board. Every year we have, they have a three-year length of their term. So every year, five positions are open. This year we have two public library trustee positions on the ballot, the special library representative, the academic library representative, and one of our three school library representatives positions is open. So please, please, if you're a director, please take a look at that and respond. Also, if you're not a director, please ask your director or whoever takes care of that at your library to do so. We really value that feedback. It's really important as we set the direction for the organization. The next thing is also a survey. Hopefully by now, and everyone should have received this, or most of you should have received this, we sent out our delivery survey. I believe that posted this week as well. Maybe even yesterday, not sure about the date, but anyway, this is an annual survey we do. We love the fact that we get a ton of response to this survey, because it really helps drive the decisions that we make about the one service that applies to all of our members across the board. So please take a look at that and respond. If you're not the person that normally fills out surveys at your library, please again, make sure the person that does sees that. We also have built in an incentive this year for early completion of that. So just another reason to do it. That's all I have, Anna. Any questions?
No, thank you very much, Leslie. That was great. I'm going to turn to Cassandra now and ask for an update on what's happening with SHARE.
Thank you so much, Anna. Well, I'm really excited to announce that we did the reservations for the Aspen program, and we had 100 libraries sign up. We had a goal of making sure that we could reach 25 libraries at $2,500 or equivalent. We hit that equivalency. And so we are moving forward with Aspen in some capacity. We're taking a look at the data to make sure it's equitable for those who have signed up, to make sure for the payments that will be the fee structure and how that will look. Usually all of our fee structure goes by revenue. And so we make sure that, as Grant was so thoughtfully pointed out, that sometimes you got a smaller population, but a little bit more money versus larger population. And it seems like you're very big, but you're not necessarily getting the revenue to go along with that. So we do base it on your actual funding. And so with that, we will be reviewing that to come up with what that will look like. And so the Share Finance and Policy Committee actually had a chance to review that yesterday. We're going to continue looking at the data, and we'll soon be making a decision on how we are moving forward with that. But I do anticipate that we will be moving forward to offer it to all of our Share members at a really great rate for everyone. And so be on the lookout for more information about that as soon as we have that. So again, thank you for everybody who signed up and who was very thoughtful about the questions you were asking and reviewing that product. So it was greatly appreciated. I do just want to note that Jennifer Baugh has released the barcoder refresher training. She's gotten some great response from that. If you have any questions, I know she is in the process of answering just reviewing with members if you have any concerns or questions. We also are looking at our end of the year for our school libraries. And so some information will be coming out about that as we prepare for that summer delivery shutdown for some of our schools and to make sure that the interlibrary loan process is working as expected. And then last but not least, Dina Porter on our administrative side is doing some zip code cleanup. So when you type in the zip code, make sure it's actually affiliated with the city or town, and to make sure that that's correct in our database. So some of the exciting things that we have going on here at Share. Does anybody have any questions? Or I do see some of our Share staff here. Does anybody want to add anything? Okay. All right. Thank you, Anna.
Thank you, Cassandra. And thanks to the rest of your team, too. I know you're all very hardworking and very responsive to our members. I work right across the hall from Dina, and everyone loves Dina and appreciates everything that she helps them to accomplish. So I know there's no one here from delivery today. They're out working, moving vans around and that kind of stuff. And as Leslie said, the delivery survey has gone out. Basically, I think, you know, one of the things they're finding challenging is that, you know, we need to replace our vans because they're aging and they've got lots of miles, but it's very hard to find vans these days. And, you know, there's a long waiting period to get them. So that's one of the many challenges they're facing. And then I don't see anyone here from marketing and communications. So I am going to talk about membership, and mostly the most of our efforts have been focused on having people complete certification. Many of you have. If you haven't done so, please do so by the end of the month. That would be great. And then we will be getting information out soon about how to enter, whether you are participating in the non-resident card program or not, and how you're doing that. And that is done through L2, and we have instructions. It's kind of, you have to kind of go in some back ways. It's not like with the other things where there's a clear link right on that first page. But we do have instructions that worked very well last year, and we will share those again. And those will probably come out in the next newsletter. So be patient with us, and you have till June to get that information entered. And if you don't enter it, of course, we will nag you for that too. So, we're also, you know, I know Ellen and Leah today are in Bloomington attending a conference, and I got something for Ellen about, you know, they have a storyteller. They have it, what did they call it? A storyologist. And I thought that was great. So I love the title. We're also very busy working on the grant for trustee training. That's going full guns ahead. And it's exciting. And I'm hoping we'll have something that we can share with all of you probably in June. And we're hoping that it'll be very useful. We have lots of involvement from trustees and a few directors from across the state. And I think what we produce will be useful. And we're trying to make it as 21st century as possible. We're including elements of AI, artificial intelligence, and also we're using gaming things. And we have a platform that a lot of colleges use for online instruction. So it should be very interesting. I'm very excited about it. And I hope you will all find it useful as well as your trustees, your library boards. And I think that's about it. I don't know if any of you would like to share anything new and exciting happening in your library. I know you're always all doing exceptional work out there, and we would love to hear about it. So you can either put it in the chat, or you can unmute yourself or raise your hand, whatever you would like to do, and we can, you know, hear what's happening in your world. So I will give you a few minutes to collect your thoughts and let you jump in. I feel like I should have what the Jeopardy clock going. Dun, 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 dun. Anyway, well, I think that's it. I'm going to, we have an author visit planned for Scott Rintigan, author of the Nyxia series. This is my first time hosting an author event. That's exciting. And that's from Hope. And I think, yeah, yay. Author events are fun. That should be really exciting. You'll have to let us know how it goes. Thanks to everyone who applied to DU 2.0. It's going to be a great time next month. That's from Amy. Okay, Wayne City said, we are hosting our first gardening workshop today from 2 to 4. Hopefully you won't get rained out. Hopefully this is an inside event. That sounds like a lot of fun. I love gardening. Anyone else, any St. Patrick's Day programming going on, or just a spring kind of stuff? Okay. Well, I thank you for sharing those bits of information. I always love hearing what's going on in our libraries. So thank you for sharing. And I think I will go ahead and bring the meeting to a close. Thank you all for joining us. I hope you enjoy the rest of your day, and we'll see you next month. Of course, we have the director's chat not today, but every Thursday afternoon that we do not, from 1 to 2, that we do not have Members Matter. So we'll either see you next month here, or we will see you in director's chat, or talk to you in director's chat. So thank you and goodbye.